In 1983, Marjorie Craig Benton, Sonny Fisher, Lucia Woods Lindley, and Iris Krieg were working individually on issues affecting women in the Chicago area. The moment they came together and invited Marcie Love to join them, the values-based, barrier-breaking Chicago Foundation for Women took off. These are the stories of the early struggles and triumphs of the Chicago Foundation for Women through the eyes of the founders and the early board members who launched CFW.
Marjorie Craig Benton. I grew up outside of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Went to a Quaker school for 10th, 11th, and 12th grades, which really changed my life. I was the last of seven children, six girls and a boy. My parents were born in Northern Ireland. My father was one of 22 children.
Sonny Fisher. I'm retired from philanthropy. I was the director of the Richard Driehaus Foundation in my last job, and then I've been consulting. I grew up in the Bronx, New York, public housing for 10 or 11 years.
I'm Iris Krieg. I was born in Philadelphia, but grew up really in Florida. But the part that I grew up in had lots and lots of Southern roots to it. So yes, I had palm trees and banana trees in my yard. I also grew up with an extraordinary amount of racism and sexism.
So I think what I learned growing up in that household was how to survive and how to negotiate, because it was a constant negotiation, as you can well imagine.
My full name is Marcina Waterman Love. I'm called Marcie. I've lived in Chicago since 1960. My husband was fifth generation Chicago. So once we fell in love and he proposed, I knew I'd be in this flat area forever because I'm from Connecticut and Pittsburgh. My father, for his generation, was a bit of a feminist. And he always said I could do anything I set my mind on between 8 and 5, that I should always be showered and dressed and the children fed when my husband came home from work. So I had to kind of 8 or 9 hours to do my thing. But Daddy really was amazing in that way of thinking that his daughters could and should do anything.
Well, my father-in-law had these five careers. At the height of Depression, started the Benton and Bowles advertising. And then he became vice president of the University of Chicago under his friend Robert Hutchins. They were both age 29. He went to be an assistant secretary of state and then senator from Connecticut and UNESCO. He was a very strict businessman, and we, as a family, acquired the Encyclopedia Britannica and the Webster's Dictionary, and then he developed the great books and so forth. So out I came to a very strange new world for me, lots of new things to learn. It wasn't said straight out, but my father-in-law, thank God, he sort of adopted me and mentored me. He just expected me to be involved in everything that he was interested in.
Just before we started the foundation, my previous employment had been with Chicago Community Trust, and Marjorie had been volunteering in several different ways with the Community Trust and had been particularly a leader around children and family work. And I was so awestruck by her capacities and her knowledge and her good humor, but her steadfastness. She's going to get stuff done and move things along. Just as a personality, she's just really someone, because I'm a little younger than she was, so she was very much of, boy, I wish I could do that. I wish I could speak up like that. I wish I could feel my own personal power in the way that she showed it.
It was when I was teaching, actually, that I met a woman. She died recently, Nancy Reichman, because her son was in my class, and Nancy and I got to be friends. And then she introduced me to Lucia Woods Lindley. And then Lucia and I started to talk about the possibility of working together. And after I left teaching, I went back for a social work degree, and I was working mostly with women in crisis. I worked as a rape victim advocate. I worked with battered women. And Lucia was particularly interested in reproductive rights. So we thought that those two issues would be a good way to start the foundation once we decided, yes, we would work together. And well, when she decided anyway, she was the boss.
Lucia Woods Lindley's family and my husband's family were very good friends. So when Lucia moved back here, we started having lunch almost monthly. And I learned about her Sophia Fund. And then she wasn't as involved or excited about CFW, but she told me about that. And of course, I got very excited about it.
My name is Juju Lin. I became involved with the CFW early on in about 1985. I was born in China and grew up in Taiwan. After finishing college in Taiwan, I came to the United States. So I'm the first generation Asian American immigrant.
It's Joe Greidel, G-R-U-I-D-L, last name Moore, M-O-O-R-E. I grew up in Minneapolis and I was married, had two kids, went to law school and practiced law for 3 years before my husband and, or I should say my spouse, my partner and I moved to Wilmette. And we didn't know how long we'd be living here, but the very first day we moved, I met someone who was involved in the Junior League of Evanston. And she was telling me how they were studying women's issues. And they were talking about domestic violence. And would I be interested in getting involved? And well, I knew several people who had survived domestic violence. I had just spent the last week helping a friend from work who had been beaten by her spouse.
My name is Judy Langford. I grew up in Georgia. I moved to Chicago in 1981 and had been active in a variety of different women's movement organizations, including coming to Illinois after my father-in-law, Jimmy Carter, was elected president when the Illinois legislature was considering the Equal Rights Amendment. Illinois could have been one of the last states to ratify the Equal Rights Amendment, but they did not at the last minute. Marjorie Benton, she was somebody that I knew really well before I ever moved to Illinois. And Marge was very much involved in the early days of organizing all kinds of things.
My name is Maria Bacilli, and I'm a founding member of the board of directors of the Chicago Foundation for Women. I was born in Cuba and came to the United States in 1961 as part of an air flight movement known as the Peter Pan flights. About 14,000 Cuban children were airlifted out of Cuba between 1960 and 1962. I lived in two foster homes in the Chicago area. I was in foster homes for about a year and a half until my parents were able to leave Cuba and we were reunited as a family in 1963.
From the moment I first came in contact with the CFW, it was just totally positive experience. I immediately felt the compassion and support from every CFW staff and board member. I feel like they have the sensitivity to and understanding of the universal women's needs. So whatever the different culture is, they understand. That was very comforting.
With Kathy Hurley, Sue Marino, Juanita Doherty, we all worked together to start the Evanston Shelter for Battered Women. It was working there that I realized, while the shelter was a short-term place for safety, that really for the women and the kids that came without just paying jobs, without safe, affordable housing, without daycare, without health care, really it was unbelievably challenging for of women to continue on with their lives. And so at one point we had enough funding to hire a social worker, and it was Sunny Fisher.
In 1985, I just finished graduate school at the University of Chicago, where I received a master's in public policy. And I got a phone call from Iris Creek inviting me to lunch. And Iris and Sunny Fisher took me to lunch, and they started to talk about this idea that was brand new. Some people thought it was somewhat revolutionary to start a foundation that would benefit women and their families. And that's how I heard about it. They took me to lunch. They told me about what they were doing, about the seed money that was available, which was amazing because most nonprofits don't start with that kind of seed money. But, you know, because of Lucia Woods Lindley and Marge Benton, we knew that we had seed money to proceed. And they invited me to join the board, and right on the spot, I said yes.
After we received the funding, we attended the first CFW's annual luncheon, and they asked all the grantees to stand up and be recognized. Now, this might seem like not a very significant gesture or something, but it really meant so much to us, to me, because we're the small grassroots women's program in the neighborhood. And we felt like we were validated by the entire women's community. And it was so affirming and encouraging.
I think about whether in the beginning we were too pussyfooted. Maybe it was just the learning curve. I don't know if that was as necessary for as long, or whether we should have been more driven.
People thought that we were offensive enough in starting a women's foundation. Why don't you connect to the Chicago Community Trust, they would say to us. There aren't enough women's groups out there to fund, they would say to us. So as we first started organizing, the fearless and fierce Diane DeWeese Smith said, we have to soften our image. And then later we said, we're in your face to stay.
Everything you did, the stakes were high because you really didn't have a track record or a history. I was always really impressed by the board and its drive to be inclusive and have as many diverse voices as possible. I was just so struck by everybody's dedication and spirit and how smart everybody was. It was this group of really smart women. We were inventing a wheel, really. It was really exciting.
I believed my core in the core beliefs of CFW.
Marcie Love was this white woman living in the suburbs from what we would consider a privileged background. And she just got it. She got it from day one. And again, there were people women who fit that profile of Marcie's that I remember talking to in the city dwellers who you would think would have a more sort of in tune of, you know, what was happening in the city, the change in demographics, who felt that, why would you be starting a foundation that would only benefit women? That doesn't make any sense. There were many people in Chicago, philanthropists, who said that to us. But Marcie was amazing. She got it from day one. And she has been a North Light in so many ways. And to this day, she continues to think out of the box and to see that we take the foundation and the work that is being done to the next level.
One of the responsibilities of the treasurer was to find an office space. And my husband's cousin was in commercial real estate, and he recommended this man. And I couldn't find a woman commercial real estate agent. And we looked at various offices and found one that I thought was within our budget. He put his hand on my thigh and said, this is fairly safe for you girls to come to and out from at night. I moved his hand, moved away, and I don't remember what I said. I just remembered how horrified I was. Working for a woman's organization, and this man thought he had the right to put his hand on my thigh. Girls,
I would say we all were uncomfortable talking about money. You know, women at that point in time were writing $25 checks for bake sales. That was the extent of their charitable contributions. Or even if they were making them to their college, it was at 10 times less what men were writing.
The other thing that bothered me for years and years and years is that you ask a woman to write a check and it'll be smaller than if you ask her husband.
I think the other thing when we started was recognizing that women did have resources to put into those things, but they had never been asked specifically to create and to donate to an organization that was really around supporting a whole variety of different women's issues. Women just were not used to giving big gifts. They would give $100. Women entrepreneurs who were making millions of dollars, it wasn't that they didn't have the money. It was that they didn't know what to do with it and had never really thought about it in that way.
One of my favorite gifts to the foundation was from a woman who wrote us a $50 check. And she said, "This is the first donation I've ever made." And she was probably in her 40s or 50s at the time, where I didn't ask my husband first. So that was we felt that said something about what we were doing and how we were doing it.
I mean, if you can imagine women having to ask their husbands to write a check.
We realized that we needed people giving at a higher level annually in order to ask them to multiply that gift several times to have a successful and worthwhile endowment campaign. And so that was the moment where we decided, all right, we're going to use the stretch gift concept and fundraising as the women's ultimate power tool, and inviting 10 individuals or couples to make a commitment of $100,000 in the next couple of years. And we decided that the next annual meeting, we were going to ask those people to stand and have them stand up and be acknowledged in front of the 1,800 people we expected at the luncheon. And we did that. And that was considered kind of a radical thing to do at the time. And it was really interesting that Marianne Philbin, who was the executive director then, and I met with a woman like 7 or 8 months later. And we were both, you know, nervous to ask her for $100,000. And when we asked her for the money, she looked at us and said, "You know, ever since that annual luncheon and I saw all those people get up, I thought, I want to be part of that group. I thought you'd never ask."
Even though our grantees were very diverse, but seems like early from the very beginning, we had difficulty attracting donors.
It was hard to engage a lot of women of color. And that is one of the things that was a great sadness for me for a long time and is a great sense of joy and forward movement that I think the foundation is not in that same spot anymore and is in a different place. So that's extraordinary and wonderful.
I wish we had had more women of color involved, probably in the steering committee. Out of 7 women, there were probably 3 women of color, but it's still, we were struggling, and I wish we had done a better job.
I don't think the feminist movement as a whole was seen as something that was very relevant to people of color. It was still seen as these are issues that come from a white perspective and didn't touch in the same way. And it may very well be that we didn't see it from those perspectives, but I think we didn't have the experiences that we would bring to it today.
Almost all of us, even the women who were running the foundations who were gay, all of us were very slow to use the word lesbian. Not proud of that at all.
There was no such thing as LGBTQ, so it was lesbian issues would be how we would refer to everything at that time, and nobody at all talked about trans women, so that was a much later phenomenon. So at that time, lesbian issues were on the boundary. So it was one thing to talk about pay issues and health issues in general, and another talk about reproductive rights and lesbian issues. Those were considered to be less mainstream women's issues.
This was a life-changing experience for me to be part of the founding of CFW. And it was a big idea. It was a new idea. And there are many more of those kinds of ideas to come. It just took a lot of persistence and organizing and camaraderie.
There's a spirit in CFW. You know, we're not a corporation. The whole mission, the whole style of operating, interacting with the grantees and among the staff and among the board members, to me, it's a sisterhood. We all just come together because we all believe in the same thing and we are willing to give our best together as a team.
It's been a priceless thing for me to be involved with. And I'm so full of gratitude.
The more that we empower women and other girls to have the opportunity to devote time to community activities and think beyond their immediate needs, the more that life will improve for them and for all of us.
There's a very firm foundation of leadership and commitment to women's issues there that will continue. And it'll be interesting from my perspective just to watch what happens.
The things I've done in my life, being one of the co-founders of Chicago Foundation for Women is something I'm very, very proud of. And I talk about it when I'm working in other organizations. So I just was very fortunate to have this experience domestically as I was working internationally, because the lessons went back and forth. Who won the world, girls, girls?